Hello students, welcome back. Myself Pushpendra Singh and we are going to start with our daily current affairs. So today you have 10th of February 2021 and we are here for your preparation. All right. So we are going to start our class today with the current affairs. So these lectures are basically meant for those students who are preparing for the civil services examination as well as other government competitive examination, which require you to answer a few questions related to your current affairs or day-to-day, you know, the news. So you must read for that your national newspaper, right? Any national newspaper, and preferably if you are preparing for the civil services examination, you must read the Hindu or you can read Indian Express. Okay, both of these newspapers are equally good. You can refer any of these newspaper. And you can also subscribe our channel on the Future IAS, where we are bringing you these current affairs related news for the daily basis. So you can always refer and you can always take the help of the Future IAS by subscribing our channel. All right. So let's begin with the news. All right. So first is basically the Lalandhar or the Shatut Dam. So this Lalandhar and or the Shatut Dam basically located in the Afghanistan. So here a memoranda of understanding was basically signed. A memoranda of understanding, that is called MOU, was signed for the construction of this dam, which is known as Lalandhar or Shatut Dam. So this dam will be constructed first of all in the Afghanistan, and it was held right on a ceremony which was held on the virtual platform on 9th of February 2021, right, between the two sides of the Afghanistan as well as the India. So both sides, the Ministry of External Affairs of Afghanistan as well as the India, basically signed in presence of the Prime Minister as well as, you know, the President of the Afghanistan. In presence of them, both External Affairs Minister basically signed this memoranda of understanding for the construction of this dam. Okay, so the second line basically says that this MOU was signed by External Affairs Minister Dr. Jaishankar as well as the foreign ministers of Afghanistan, Mr. Hanif Atmar, right? Both have signed this MOU in the presence of the Prime Minister Narendra Modi as well as the President of Afghanistan, Dr. Mohammad Ashraf Ghani. Both have signed this MOU. This project is basically the second project in the line, right, for development of dam, right? And it will be a new development partnership between India and Afghanistan. Obviously, the bilateral relationship between the two countries, between India and Afghanistan, will further give boost, right, by the generous help provided by the India to the Afghanistan in terms of, you know, building of those infrastructure, building of those assets and construction of such dams. Obviously will bring the soft corner, or will bring basically the soft, you know, the diplomacy. It will basically give the fruit in terms of better relationship between India and Afghanistan in the coming years to come. All right. So this dam, which is also known as Lalandhar Dam or the Shatut Dam, would meet, right, various requirement of the people which resides in the city Kabul as well as nearby area. So it will first of all provide the drinking water. So safe drinking water will be provided from this dam, right, to the inhabitants of the Kabul city. It will also provide the irrigation water, right, to the nearby areas, right. And it will also, you know, this help or this MOU would also say about rehabilitation of existing irrigation and the drainage network, right, which are outdated and which require certain rehabilitation of those existing network, which will also be provided, right, in terms of certain aid. The aid will also be provided under MOU in terms of the flood protection, right, in the areas nearby the Kabul city, as well as it will also provide the aid for the management effort in those areas, right? And also, it will also provide the electricity to this region. So, lot of objectives or lot of, you know, issues or lot of important, you know, areas have been included in the MOU, right? So, this MOU provide the drinking water, right? Irrigation facilities, you know, rehabilitation of existing infrastructure in terms of irrigation and the drainage network, flood protection, management, and providing the electricity to that region, right? As I told you that it is the second such major dam project which was built by the India, obviously, right, in the Afghanistan, right? The first such dam was built was known as Salma Dam. It was built under the India-Afghanistan Friendship Dam, or it is also known as India-Afghanistan Friendship Dam, which was inaugurated by the Prime Minister and the President in June 2016, right? So this is the second such dam, which is known, which will be known as Lalanda Dam or Shatut Dam, which will provide much further, you know, the better avenues for the better, you know, bilateral relationship between India and Afghanistan. All right, so here you can see both sides have been standing, right, on the virtual platform where you have the Jaishankar, right, who is External Affairs Minister, Prime Minister Narendra Modi, right, and the External Affairs Minister of Afghanistan, and he is basically the Ashraf Ghani, who is basically the President of Afghanistan. All right, next is excessive uses of fertilizer. So first of all, you know, the fertilizer is one such input for agricultural operations, right? So you have different type of fertilizers like nitrogenous fertilizers, phosphatic fertilizers, potassic fertilizers, isn't it? So you have different type of fertilizers. But the point is that our farmers are generally not aware of the uses of the fertilizers. And moreover, the fertilizers also, you know, cost the farmers to the deer, right? It cost heavily to the farmers. And since they are not aware of the exact, you know, the status of their soil, right, whether the soil is deficient in nitrogen, whether the soil is deficient in phosphatic, right, or in the potash, the farmers ultimately ended up of using the excessive amount of fertilizers, right? So that is the context of this news. So excessive amount of fertilizers, mainly the nitrogenous fertilizer, is basically used because it is subsidized and it is cheaper also, right? Farmers think that if we use the nitrogenous, it's okay, it will boost the fertility, but it is not happening. What is happening is that the excessive uses of fertilizer has led to the soil toxicity, right, as well as, you know, different type of other problems, right? So you will have other, you know, the soil related complications, right, as well as, you know, the soil fertility also declined over the period of the time. So here the Union Minister of the Agriculture informed the Lok Sabha about excessive uses of fertilizer in India. Okay, so here the investigations related to to ascertaining the right status of the uses of the fertilizer, this investigation was carried out under All India Coordinated Research Project on long-term fertilizer experiment, right? Over the 5 decades, that under this experiment of 5, you know, different sites have been selected, right? And which is basically, you know, these sites have been undertaken continuous use of nitrogenous fertilizers alone. So this continuous use of nitrogenous fertilizers again has led to, you know, adverse effect on the soil health, because it increases the soil toxicity, it depleted the soil nutrients, right? It basically, you know, makes soil infertile, it reduces, you know, the productivity of the soil, ultimately the production will decline. Obviously, when these nutrients reaches to the water bodies, right, again phytoplanktons, different type of, you know, other, you know, which is leading to, you know, if in the water body, especially because of this excessive uses of the fertilizers. So a lot of other negative impacts are there of uses of this negative fertilizers, right? And crop productivity is also showing deficiencies of other major and the micronutrients, isn't it? Obviously, when you excessive use the nitrogenous fertilizer, you will have the deficiency of other micronutrients, other major nutrients also, isn't it? The data which was collected, the consumption of chemical fertilizers here, when you say the chemical fertilizers, I mean here the all type of fertilizers. So that means the nitrogenous fertilizer, you have the urea, diammonium, years in 2017-18, it was 54.38, you know, million tons of the fertilizers which used. 2018-19, 56.21. 2019-20, it was 59.88. And 2020-21 up to the Kharif, right, it was 33.85. So you can see it is continuously increasing. And I hope to, for 2020-21, it will also increase further and it will cross 59.88 million tons also, right? So we are using excessive use of these fertilizers, right? Mainly the nitrogenous fertilizer, which is not good for the soil health. All right. Then Gujarat two child policy. Okay, so the background is that you know that the population is growing very fast. Okay, the population explosion, right? Because of that, what is happening is that the Gujarat government has brought, you know, in 2005 a Gujarat Local Authority Act, or it basically, you know, amended this Local Authority Act in 2005. Okay, the ultimate aim of amendment of this Local Authority Act by the Gujarat government, right, is to prevent especially the members of the panchayats, the councillors of the municipality or the municipal corporations from having more than two children, right? Right, it is the precondition, right? If you have more than two children, you will be disqualified. You will be disqualified from the post of the member of panchayat, right? Or the councillor of municipality or the municipal corporation. So this is the background. Now what happens is three such candidates of the municipal corporation of Vadodara and the municipal corporation of Rajkot, three such candidates have been disqualified recently, right, under this, you know, act by the government of Gujarat, right, under two child policy, right, under the state of government, under the state of Gujarat. So here the nomination for such three people or three candidates was challenged, right, and each of these three candidates, you know, have the three children, right? So each of these, you know, the candidate has the three children, and that was the reason they were basically disqualified. So the context I have given you, that in 2005 the Gujarat government amended the Gujarat Local Authority Act ultimately to prevent, right, you know, having more than two children, right, to become a member of your panchayat or councillor of municipality. All right, now this amendment, since it is related to the local government, right, so local government includes, right, not only the panchayat but also the Gujarat Provincial Municipal Corporations Act as well as the Gujarat Panchayati Raj Act. So here this amendment added the clauses to other acts also which is relevant to the local administrative bodies. These local administrative bodies, for example, you know that at the rural level you have the panchayat, so obviously you will have the Gujarat Panchayat Act, and as well as, right, at the urban area you have the municipal corporations, municipalities, right? So for that you have the Gujarat Provincial Municipal Corporation Act 1949. Both of these acts have been amended, and both of these acts have amended or added certain clause regarding this disqualification for the members if they have more than two children, right, as a membership of these bodies. All right, the rationale behind, you know, amending these, you know, local body act basically related to, you know, the, you know, controlling or stabilizing the growing population, right, in the Gujarat state. So again, this is only, you know, related to controlling the state population in the local bodies, right, and because of that this act were basically amended. All right, so you can see husband, wife and their two children. All right, next, the increasing glacial lakes. So first of all, you might have heard about the Uttarakhand, the glacial outburst lake, right? So these glacial lakes which are growing, you know, because of the climatic change. Now I have given you in my last class or in the yesterday's lecture what is glacial lake outburst. First of all, so before we moving to the glacial lake outburst, you must understand what are the glacial lakes. So glacial lakes are basically naturally created, right, because of the climatic change. Right, what happens is you have the moraines. Moraines means they are basically the remnants of, you know, some of the pebbles, sediments, right, stones which are left out after the glacier melt out, right? So when the glacier melt, certain sediments have been left out in terms of stones, pebbles and etc., right? So they basically make a, you know, a temporary embankment, right? And this temporary embankment basically, you know, built like a dam. So here the water is basically collected, and what happens is this is very unstabilized. Any point of the time it can break because it is not human made. It is just, you know, the naturally made, and it is very, very, you know, unstable also. So whenever you have certain other changes like further melting of, you know, the glacier or certain movement of the glacier, what happens is there is always a chance of the breaking down of these glacial lakes, and that phenomena we call glacial lake outburst. And that is the reason the Uttarakhand is basically facing the flash floods, right? So, you know, the scientists having, you know, warning that there are further dangers of such type of glacial outburst floods, right? Or the glacial lakes might further, you know, break down, right, in the near future also, and that may cause, you know, the imminent dangers to the Himalayan states like Uttarakhand from such, you know, the natural process like landslides, snow avalanche, right? You have the cloud burst, right? You have the lake burst, different type of natural disaster occur, right? Certain element of anthropogenic, you know, regions are also involved, obviously. The climate is changing with that pace because of the anthropogenic, involvement, right? So the pace has increased, right? Otherwise, there is nothing wrong in formation of the glacial lake, but the pace has increased. And because of that, right now we are facing a danger of, you know, the loss, significant loss, right? So the glaciers are basically the largest source of fresh water outside the polar region. For example, you have the North Pole and you have the South Pole. So outside this North Pole and South Pole, you have glaciers atop of certain mountains, right? So here on the Himalayan reaches, you have certain glaciers also, right? These glaciers are having tremendous significance, right? To all of the countries, right? For example, if you consider the India, right? These glaciers, all the snow, whenever they melt, obviously, they sustain, first of all, the Himalayan ecosystem in terms of flora and the fauna. And also, these glaciers and the snow, they are also source of certain rivers which basically originate from the Himalayan, you know, reaches, right, to the higher level, right? So for example, you have the Indus, you have the Brahmaputra, all basically originate from the glacier which are located in the Himalayan region, right? So certain sources of the water for the several rivers basically in our subcontinent is also most important for, you know, in terms of the preservation, you know, conservation of those glaciers, right? And they also responsible for maintaining the perennial supply of water. Perennial means throughout the year. Throughout the year, these glaciers feed the water in the rivers. And that is the reason, right, the Indus, Brahmaputra, right, Ganga to the upper stretches or to the upper course, right, they are also perennial. That means throughout the year, you will have water, right? Like you have the Indus, Ganga, Brahmaputra are over, you know, billions of the people dependent on these rivers. Okay. Now, these glaciers are retreating very fast, right? Retreating means they have been melting down very fast, right? So they have been reducing in terms of their mass, in terms of their surface area, right? Since, you know, recently because of this climatic change, right? Some models in terms of some scientific, prediction says that the increase of the global temperature by average of 2 degrees Celsius between 1850 to 2070, right? It will result into the reduction of, right, 45% of the medium and the large glaciers. That means 45% of the medium and the large glaciers will be completely disappeared, right? And around 70% of the smaller glaciers are likely to be melt away, right, by 2070. So you can say if you consider this span of 1850 to 2070, 45% of the large glaciers and the medium glaciers will be completely vanished, right? Completely disappeared. And this will lead to further the formation of these glacial lakes and further endanger the life in the Himalayan region, right? And shrinking these glaciers has led to the formation of large number of glacial lakes, as I told you, right? Obviously, that will, you know, endanger, that will basically, you know, that will also, you know, increases the chances of the burst of these lakes, right? And there is further chances of inundation of these higher reaches of the Himalayas, right? So because they are located in the high altitudes, obviously, whenever they breach, obviously, they will bring a lot of, you know, the gallons of the water at a, you know, for the shorter span of the time. So that is the reason they are potentially very dangerous, right? And they cause flash floods, just like in Uttarakhand Chamoli district, we have, you know, facing such flood, and, you know, hundreds of the people died because of these flash floods. Okay. In 2005, the study by the Kathmandu based, the International Center for Integrated Mountain Development, right, has listed around 127 such lakes in the Uttarakhand state itself, right, which is now increasing to multifold to 400, right? It is increasing because of the climatic change. the glaciers are retreating, the glaciers are melting, and this, you know, temporary embankment has led to the formation of these glacial lakes, and it can also breach at any point of the time. All right. So you can see here the lakes are basically over there, and they are basically because of this melt of the ice, it can breach at any point of the time. Okay, then pre and the post-metric scholarship scheme. So here, the pre and the post-metric scholarship scheme is provided by the Government of India, by the Department of Social Justice and the Empowerment, right? So here, the Minister of Social Justice and the Empowerment basically informed the Lok Sabha about certain changes or the modifications which have been brought in the pre-metric scholarship scheme for the scheduled caste as well as for the OBCs, and the post-metric scholarship scheme for the scheduled caste as well as for OBCs. So certain changes which have been made under the scheme is follow, right? So you see basically the pre-metric scholarship for the scheduled caste students. So here the funding pattern, right, related to the pre-metric scholarship for the scheduled caste students was revised, right? Which is basically fixed, right? Sharing pattern between 60 to 40 ratio, right? That was 60 share will come from the center, and the 40% of that scholarship, you know, fund comes from the state, right? This 60 to 40 is basically 90 to 10 in the certain northeastern states. Okay, this changes in such a way that this share or 60 to 40 or 90 to 10 or the notional allocation, which is basically allocated for this scheme, whichever will be the lower, that will be the funding pattern under this scheme. Okay. And under this scheme, also the annual family income limit was also increased so that more people can come into the ambit of this scheme. So it has increased from 2 lakh rupees to 2.5 lakh rupees in 2018. And the rate of maintenance allowance, which was given under the pre-metric scholarship for the scheduled caste students, was also increase in 2018. Okay, regarding the post-metric scholarship for the scheduled caste students, right, here in 2020-21, right, you know, the Union Cabinet basically approved the continuation of that scheme, that is post-metric scholarship for the scheduled caste students from the year 2020-21 to 2025-26. That means for the 5 years, the scheme was extended, right? And the revised pattern is basically, you know, remains same. That was 60 to 40 between center and the states, and that was 90 to 10 in case of northeastern state. That means 90% of that funding comes from the center and 10% of the funding comes from the states. All right. Then pre-metric scholarship for the other backward classes and the post-metric scholarship for the OBCs. So here for OBCs also, there are certain schemes or scholarship related to, you know, the pre-metric and the post-metric, right? So here the income limit have also changed, right, for both pre-metric as well as for the post-metric scholarship. So here the scholarship which is provided, right, to the OBCs has increased from 1 lakh rupees to 2.5 lakh rupees per annum. For the post-metric scholarship, right, this has increased from 1.5 lakh to 2.5 lakh rupees per annum. So again, these changes have been made recently by the Government of India. Okay, next is road accidents. Okay, everybody knows about road accidents, right? Road accident, India is, you know, is the world first country, or it is ranked first country in terms of the number of accidents. The number of accidents, right, happens, right? So you must understand the number of accidents and the deaths which is occurring in India. The India stands first in such accidents, right, which is also ahead of US and China also. Now, the Union Minister of Road Transport and the Highways, right, has called all around effort, right, by all stakeholders to reduce the deaths which is caused by the road accidents, right, to by 50% by 2025. So the Union Minister for Road Transport and the Highways called, right, all effort by all stakeholders to reduce the deaths due to the road accident, right, by 50% by 2025. Okay. Now, the Union Home Minister termed the situation is alarming. The situation is alarming because a lot of, you know, lives have been lost on the roads, right? And, you know, the minister basically, you know, said also that India stands number one position in terms of the road accidents in the world, which is also far ahead of US and the China in that aspect. around 1.5 lakh people die on the road accident every year, right? And every year, more than 4.5 lakh people injured on the road accidents, right? Combinedly, you say on an average, 415 deaths per day occur on the road accidents in India, around 415 deaths. Okay, and this has caused around 14% of the national GDP of India in terms of their socio-economic losses to those accidents, right? So 14% of such loss occur to national GDP, and 70% of such deaths are in the age group of 18 to 45 years old. All right, so you can see basically a car which was damaged because of the road accident. Okay, the National Monsoon Mission. This National Monsoon Mission, first of all, was initiated by the minister, by the Ministry of Earth Sciences. So here the Ministry of Earth Sciences informed the Raj Sabha about the National Monsoon Mission. The National Monsoon Mission, first of all, you must understand, under National Monsoon Mission, right, the main objective is to develop the state-of-art weather predicting system, weather forecasting system, the state-of-art climate prediction systems or the models, right, which are now operational or which are now in the uses, right? So these models which was developed as a state-of-art prediction system, right, basically of three types, right? So for short range to the medium range, for 1 to 10 days forecasting or prediction, one model is there. For extended range, that means from 10 days to 30 days, another model we have. And for the seasonal, you have up to for one season, you have another set of models which will basically predict such type of weather and the climatic phenomena. Okay, the following are the targets of the monsoon mission. For example, under this National Monsoon Mission, following are the targets which are there. Okay, now here, the development of seamless prediction system. Obviously, because you have lot of losses to the agricultural productivity, right? You have lot of losses of the life also because of flooding and because of other phenomena. So obviously, the prediction system would be best, right? For monsoon forecasting, right? So here the four different, time scales are used basically. For example, for seasonal forecasting or seasonal prediction, that means for the monsooning season, for extended range up to 4 weeks, for the short range up to 5 days. So you need to develop that type of models for these prediction. Okay, and it will also initiate and coordinate the working partnership between Indian and the foreign institutes. Obviously, the alone India cannot be self-sufficient in terms of formation of these models. You need to take support, you need to coordinate with some of the foreign institutions to develop the state of art, the prediction system, to develop this prediction of the extreme and the climatic variations, changes, right? So that you can forecast exactly, right, what is that, okay? And you have to develop and implement system for the climatic applications having social impacts, because you must understand the agriculture dependent on the monsoon. If you do not forecast, how will you able to tell the farmers that you need to show your crop at that point of the time? So for agricultural purpose, it will have lot of social aspect or social impact also. For flood forecast also, untimely rain, heavy rain at one point of the time, right? All such causes the floods, right? Extreme events also, you have like cyclones related, flooding and all sort of things. Wind energy, right? All such require basically the better prediction, better forecasting of weather and the climate. Okay, for that, you need advanced data assimilation system for preparing this high quality data for the model predictions, right? So all such data assimilation system will also be required, because you need to feed, in these models certain data which will basically require the high quality data, right, for these model predictions, right? Then only the model will be predicting 100% accurate result. All right. Next, the National Research Center for MACHNA. MACHNA, you people already knows, right? So these are basically MACHNAs, right? So here the National Research Center for the MACHNAs is basically operational. So Union Minister for the Agriculture basically informed the Lok Sabha about the National Research Center for MACHNA. So this, the National Research Center for the MACHNA was under the Indian Council of Agriculture Research, which is the premier agriculture research organization, which is named as ICAR, National Research Center for Makhna, which was set up in Darbhanga, Bihar, right, which was sanctioned by the Department of Agriculture Research and Education under Government of India, right, which was started as a scheme during ninth five-year plan between 1997 to 2002, right, for conserving, for the research and for the development of makhna crop. Now you must understand that Darbhanga is one of the largest producer of makhna in India, or leading producer of makhna in India, and that was the reason the Indian Council of Agriculture Research led, the National Research Center was set up, right, in the basically Darbhanga, Bihar, which was sanctioned by the Department of Agriculture Research and Education during 9th five-year plan. Now what happens is, during 10th five-year plan between 2002 and 2007, this National Research Center for the Makhna was basically merged and brought under the administrative control of Indian Council of Agriculture Research, Research Complex for the Eastern Region. So it was merged and brought under administrative control of the RCER, Patna, without changing the mandate. So mandate remains same, but their administrative control, their independent entity, which was completely merged, right, with basically ICER Patna, without changing their mandate. Now Darbhanga and Mithila, right, is basically a major producing region in our country, right? So the mainly, the makhna is basically produced in the Darbhanga region of Bihar. Okay, next, lithium. So lithium, all you know, the lithium has tremendous application. Lithium is basically one of the element, right, which is also named in our periodic table. So recently the lithium is in the news because of certain media reports, right, about the lithium reserve which was found in the Karnataka. So the media reports that the, you know, lot of lithium reserve have been found in the Karnataka region. So here the Atomic Mineral Directorate basically clarified, right, regarding the reserves which were found in basically in the Karnataka region. So here the Atomic Mineral Directorate for the exploration and the research of certain minerals or atomic minerals, right, which is basically a constituent unit of Department of Atomic Energy, right? So this Atomic Mineral Directorate, along with that the Geological Survey of India, both of these agencies are basically exploring the minerals, right, in the basically in the Karnataka region, right? And the lithium is basically, is having tremendous application. For example, you have the lithium ion batteries, which is basically also used in the ceramics, in the glass industries, in the telecommunication sector, in the aerospace industries. Now you have, the batteries, right? So it will have tremendous, industrial and technological applications also, right? And in the thermonuclear applications also, that the lithium has tremendous application. Right, in the thermonuclear applications, makes the lithium as a prescribed substance. That means it will have also utility in terms of thermonuclear applications under Atomic Energy Act 1962, and which has led to the empowerment of Atomic Minerals Directorate for the exploration and the research for such prescribed substance on the Indian soil, isn't it, under Atomic Energy Act. So, which has led to the Atomic Mineral Directorate to, to explore this mineral in the Indian region. But now what happens is, it is recently in the news that the lithium exploration and the resources which was found, especially in the Karnataka region, where the Allapatna, Marlaga sector in basically Srirangapatna Taluk of Mandya district of Karnataka have been, reported a huge amount of resources of the lithium, right? These reports have been circulated on the some of the media, right, channels, and the media basically shows that, whopping around 14,100 tons of the lithium have been found on the patch area of the Mandya district of Southern Karnataka. But the Atomic Mineral Directorate later clarified that it is not about 14,100 tons of the lithium which we have found, but based on the exploration effort till now, so far we have established only 1,600 tons of lithium, not 14,100 tons of lithium, and that too in the inferred category. That means you have the low level of confidence of finding the even 1600 tons of the lithium in the basically Alapatna, right, Marlaga sector in the Srirangapatna taluk of Mandya district of Karnataka. All right, so you can see basically here it is, you know, element in our atomic, in our basically periodic table, right? So the atomic number for the lithium is 3, the symbol is Li, that is lithium. Electronic configuration is 2s1, so that is 1s2 2s1, because atomic number is 3, so that is 2 plus 1, so that is 2 plus 1, so atomic configuration is obviously 2s1, so that is why it is written here is 2s1. All right, and the atomic weight is 6.941. exactly, it is having the crystal structure, so it is alkali, comes under the alkali metal, it is solid, it is having the body centric cubic structure, and it is strongly basic in the nature. So these are some of the chemical and the physical properties related to lithium. Okay, next is National Ayush Mission, that is called NAM. So what is this National Ayush Mission? First of all, you must understand, the National Ayush Mission was implemented as a centrally sponsored scheme by the government of India. Okay, and it was implemented through the states and the union territories, with the help of states and the union territories, right, for the development and the promotion of Ayush, for the development and the promotion of Ayush. So what is that Ayush system means? Ayush, everybody knows about Ayush, means you have Ayurveda, okay, then you have yoga and naturopathy. Okay, what is U? U means Yunani. Okay, what is S? Means it is Siddha. Okay, and what is H? H means homeopathy. All right, so it is the Ayurveda, yoga, naturo, yoga and naturopathy, that is Y, Yunani, Siddha and homeopathy, right? So here it is a one branch of medicine, right, which include the Ayurveda also. So the central government tried to promote, right, the Ayush systems in our medical sector, right, by the promotion of certain schemes related to Ayush. So here, right, the mission basically, you know, makes the following provision for the promotion of this Ayush system. So first of all, the co-location of Ayush facilities at the primary healthcare centers. So you might have seen also in your district that in the primary healthcare sector, certain facilities related to Ayush is also being set up in the district centers, also in the district hospitals also, the Ayush, you know, facilities have been set up. So co-location, that means both of these Ayush facilities as well as your, you know, allopathic facilities, right? So both of these facilities will be co-located, that means they will be located at a place, at the primary healthcare center, at the community healthcare center level, as well as at the district hospital level. Now, upgradation of exclusive state government Ayush hospitals and the dispensaries. That means exclusive state government Ayush hospitals and the dispensaries will be upgraded, right? Where the state government will also have their role to play. Then setting up of around 50 bed integrated Ayush hospital. So this 50 bed Ayush hospital will be setting up of for the better delivery of this Ayush related, you know, services. Then upgradation of state government undergraduate and postgraduate educational institutions. So here, no, existing government institutions which are undergraduate and postgraduate, which will be upgraded to integrate the Ayush related facilities, right? As well as the setting up of new state government Ayush educational institutions. So, you know, in the certain states, Ayush educational institutions are not there, right? For in those states, the right new state government, you know, the state government will also help in terms of, you know, the establishment of such Ayush educational institutions, right? So that this Ayush related services will also be available to the people. Okay, then strengthening of the state government cooperatives or the public sector undertakings for the manufacturing of quality medications in the Ayush sectors also, right? So here, in order to provide, you know, the affordable quality medicines in the Ayush system, right, the strengthening of the state government, you know, the cooperatives, public sector undertakings are very much important for the manufacturing of these medicines. Obviously, you need to strengthen the state drug testing laboratories also, if you want to provide this quality, you know, medicines in the Ayush sector. For that, a stringent quality control is also required. So for that, the government will also provide or will also promote the stringent quality control related to these medicines also. Then support for the cultivation of medicinal plant, because all such, the Ayurveda, Yunani, Siddha, Naturopathy, Yoga, all such require basically certain set of medicinal plants related, inputs. So the support for the cultivation of medicinal plant is also will be promoted, which will also, promote in terms of their processing, in terms of their post-harvest management, so that the quality raw material related to this Ayush medicines will also be brought in under this scheme. All right. So this is basically National Ayush Mission. All right. So thank you very much for attending this session. We'll meet again tomorrow. Till then, all the best. Bye.